Hi everybody, thank you for clicking on my video. If you're new here, hi, my name is Casey and I upload videos every Wednesday on the lesser known missing person cases that haven't received a whole lot of media attention. I mean absolutely no harm or disrespect in these videos, I am simply trying to spread awareness, and if you would like to support me, please hit that subscribe button and give this video a like. After you watch the video, I would appreciate it if you would put your theories in the comments below, as I love receiving comments and hearing other people's point of views. Today's case is very frustrating. It will probably make you angry. It totally pissed me off while I was researching it. It is the case of a 23-year-old man who runs off with a 14-year-old and absolutely nothing is done about it. Jessica Ann Kinsey was a 14-year-old 7th grader at Union Middle School in Union, Missouri, and she had a very shy nature when interacting with unfamiliar people, but she was very outgoing and talkative when she was with her friends. Jessica was a typical 14-year-old girl. You know, she loved Dirty Dancing, who didn't back then? And she loved Saved by the Bell and America's Funniest Home Videos. She loved Mexican food. She collected porcelain dolls and her favorite color was hunter green. And she had a dog named Max that she absolutely adored. It was December 26, 1995, the day after Christmas, and Jessica had received a new jacket, purse, gloves, and a scarf that she kind of wanted to show off. So she decided she was going to go hang out with one of her friends at her friend's house. So she went over to this friend's house, and her mother, Mary Klein, was working from home that day. And Jessica called her mom at 2 o'clock, letting her know that she was having a good time and that she would call her mom back around 5 o'clock to let her know if she was staying there for dinner or not. But 5 o'clock rolled around and Jessica did not call her mother and she did not show up at home. So her mother called the friend's mom and said, "Hey, where is she?" And the mother informed her
that a boy named Jimmy Hopkins had picked up Jessica.
Now Mary Klein, Jessica's mother, was not happy about this. Jimmy was 23 years old and he was the son of one of her friends and he had absolutely no reason to be picking Jessica up. The friend's mom told Mary that when Jessica left with Jimmy, she had said, "Call my mom, let her know Jimmy came and got me." But the mother did not do so. Jessica's mom immediately called the police because Jimmy was 23 years old. Jessica was 14. He had no reason to be hanging out with her. And she also knew Jimmy because she was good friends with his mother. Later that evening, Jimmy's mother and his wife, yes, he was married, showed up at Jessica's mom's house and told her that he had told them that he was going to get Jessica, but he had stolen his wife's birth certificate, social security card, and driver's license. So it's kind of easy to assume that he was going to use these for Jessica, maybe to pass her off as an adult. A local man named Mark Henderson came forward saying that Jimmy paid him to drive Jessica and he out of the state and that he drove them to Indiana, where Jimmy had said that he had relatives that were going to meet up with them and take Jessica and him on a honeymoon. He said that Jessica was pregnant with his child and that they were going to Niagara Falls to get married. When they arrived in Indiana in the early evening hours, Mark, Jessica, and Jimmy checked into the Dollar Inn Hotel in Cloverfield, Indiana.
Jimmy and Jessica checked into room 222, while Mark checked into adjacent room number 224.
That night, Mark heard violent, loud noises coming from Jimmy and Jessica's room, so he decided he better go check it out. And when he went and knocked on the door, no one would answer. And he stood there knocking for about 5 minutes before Jimmy opened the door and said, "Oh no, everything's fine. We were just having, you know, rough sex," is what he said. And the funny thing is he was fully clothed and he wouldn't let Mark in the room. He was kind of blocking the entrance. And I kind of got the idea that maybe Mark wasn't the sharpest tool in the shed. He is just oblivious to things going on around him, or, you know, noticing red flags and that things are obviously very wrong, because he, you know, thought, "Oh, okay, a 14-year-old girl in a room with a 23-year-old man, sounds like banging's going on, no big deal," and he just went back to his room and went back to bed. The next morning when Mark woke up, Jimmy and Jessica were gone. They had vanished along with his car. Mark reported his two-door 1994 aqua-colored Chevy Cavalier missing to the police, but Cloverdale police failed to enter the car into the National Crime Information Database for more than 30 days. So they totally lost the opportunity for law enforcement to maybe stop the vehicle somewhere and intervened in Jimmy taking Jessica even farther away from home. The next day on December 27th, Jimmy pawned some of his grandmother's rings at a pawn shop in Paris, Tennessee, which was 320 miles away from Cloverdale where they were last seen. Less than 2 weeks later, Mark's car was found, and it was found in Compton, California, and it had been dropped off at a garage there on January 6th by an unidentified black man. While in California, Jimmy had worked at a yogurt shop on the corner of Sunset Boulevard, and the owner of the shop said that there was a girl that would come and visit him almost every day while he was working. And other witnesses said that they had seen him many times with a girl that fit Jessica's description. So investigators believe that she did make it to California. Jessica's mother adamantly denied that Jessica had any kind of relationship with Jimmy or that she was dating him, and she said she had medical reasons that she knew that her daughter couldn't have been pregnant at the time. She had no doubt that her daughter would have gotten into the car with Jimmy because she knew him, and she was very naive, and she didn't want to believe that there were bad people in the world. And also, she knew Jimmy. Their mothers were friends and had been for a very long time. She had known Jimmy, you know, for years, and so she had no reason to not trust him. Jessica's best friend Eileen also mentioned that she and Jessica didn't keep secrets, and Jessica never mentioned a boyfriend, and if she was dating someone or was interested in someone, she would not have kept that a secret. That would have been like a hot topic for them. No one believed that Jessica would have willingly run away from her family and not contacted anyone, especially her mom.
At the time of her disappearance, Jessica was 5'5" tall and 160 pounds. She has brown hair and hazel eyes, and she wears eyeglasses. She has a small scar on her inner left forearm near her elbow, and her ears are pierced. She was last seen wearing a white turtleneck, a green sweatshirt, a green leather jacket, dark green Levi jeans, black sneakers, and a hunter green ponytail holder.
In the late spring or early summer of 1996, Jimmy did return to Missouri, but he returned without Jessica. He was somehow able to elude police until November, so he was in town for months before they even questioned him about Jessica's disappearance. And when they did finally get to talk to him, Jimmy told police that he had absolutely not harmed Jessica, and he gave the police and members of his own family varying accounts of what had happened to her. One of his stories was that the last time he saw her, she was at a hotel in Hollywood, California with a Mexican man named Capone. He willingly gave them the address for the hotel so they could go search it and find her. But when it was checked out, the address turned out to be nothing but a vacant lot. For years, Jimmy taunted Jessica's mother and her family, and was even said to have yelled across the parking lot to her mother that Jessica was dead and that she just needed to get over it. Allegedly, he told people years later that he had murdered Jessica and disposed of her body. One of the investigators on the case made sure to approach Jimmy every single year and ask him about Jessica, but Jimmy always demanded a lawyer immediately and would refuse to talk. But the investigator continued to ask him all the time because he didn't want Jimmy to think that anybody had forgotten about her. There was never enough evidence to file charges on him. However, I disagree. Okay, maybe you can't file charges for murder because there's no body and there's no proof that Jessica was actually harmed, but what about kidnapping? You could charge him with kidnapping, statutory rape, contributing to the delinquency of a minor, harboring a runaway, something. He did terrible things. He took her. He wasn't allowed to. Why can't you charge him with that? In 1998, Jessica's parents left Union and moved to Independence, Missouri, but they have never given up on her. Jessica's mother doesn't want to believe that her daughter is dead, but she does believe that Jimmy murdered her in that hotel room and then put her in the car and left and disposed of her body later. And in 2006, they did hold a memorial service for Jessica. Jessica was never found, never heard from again, nothing. And the only person that knew anything was Jimmy. And in 2008, Jimmy was married to a different woman, and he handcuffed her hands behind her back and shot her to death and then turned the gun on himself. So whatever he knew, he took with him. Something I did not mention in her description was that she may have the name Capone tattooed on her neck. And the reason I mention it now, but the reason I didn't mention it in the previous description is because I think it's made up. I could not find anything to where or why that was listed in her description, but I think it was something Jimmy made up. So I'm putting it here now.
If you have any information on Jessica Ann Kinsey's disappearance, please call the Union Police Department at 636-583-5700 or the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children at 1-800-THE-LOST or 1-800-843-5678.
Please keep Jessica's story out there by sharing her flyer, sharing this video, and sharing information on this case. Thank you all so much for watching my video. If you liked it, please leave a thumbs up and hit that subscribe button. I upload every single Wednesday, and I'll see you next time. Bye.